our lack of the Holy Spirit's presence within our lives means that Christianity, by and large, doesn't make sense. There are things we may understand, but doesn't make sense and certainly doesn't thrill us and doesn't excite us.
I've had many tears and sorrows. I've had questions for the morrow. There's been times I didn't know right from wrong. But in every situation, God gave a blessed consolation that my trials come to only make me strong. I've been a lot of places and I've seen millions of faces. And there were times I stood there all alone. It's in those lonely hours, those precious lonely hours, Jesus let me know I was His own. And oh, through it all, I've learned to trust in Jesus. I've learned to trust in God. Through it all, I've learned to depend upon His word. So I thank God for the mountains. I thank Him for the valleys. I thank Him for the storms He brought me through. And if I never had any problems, I wouldn't know my God could solve them. And I wouldn't know what faith in God's word could do. And that's why I'm singing through it all. Through it all, I've learned to trust in Jesus. I've learned to trust in God. Through it all, whoa, through it all, I've learned to depend. And I've learned to depend. I've learned to depend upon His word.
Growing up in Christ, a second series of messages from Charles Price based on the book of Ephesians. This series teaches us how to be drawn into a closer relationship with Christ through the working of the Holy Spirit. Today's message is called, Be Filled with the Spirit.
Now, if you got your Bible, I'm going to read you from the letter of Paul to the Ephesians. I'm going to read from chapter 5. Ephesians is one of the 13 letters written by Paul in the New Testament. Ephesus was a town in what is today Turkey. Then it was known as Asia Minor. Paul had founded a church there and had been in touch with it on a number of occasions. And we've been looking at this particular letter over many weeks now. And I want to read from chapter 5 and verse 15 down to verse 21. Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 15, I'm reading from the New International Version, where Paul says, Be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. Do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit. Speak to one another with psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Sing and make music in your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. I'm just going to read that far this morning. Somebody has tried to count how many commands there are given to Christians in the New Testament. I don't know how they distinguish one from another, but they came up with a number of 1,050. Many of them are personal commands. A lot of them are corporate commands, such as Jesus saying to his disciples, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. But none of these commands, especially those to Christian action, will be effective unless we understand and live in the good of the command given in verse 18, when Paul writes, do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit. Now, there are two commands there, if you think about it. The first command is, do not get drunk on wine. So if you feel tempted on your way home this morning to drop into a pub and get drunk, don't. That's very simple, very straightforward, easily dealt with. The second command is equally a command, but be filled with the Spirit. And that is not so straightforward and not so easily dealt with. It's often easier to deal with the negative commands than it is to deal with all that's involved in the positive issues that we are to engage with. Now, when Paul says this here in chapter 5, in the earlier chapters, he's already talked a lot about the work of the Holy Spirit in a Christian's life. We've mentioned some of these specifically earlier. Chapter 2, verse 18, he says, you have access to the Father by one Spirit. Your communion with God is through the enabling of the Holy Spirit. In chapter 2, verse 22, he says, you are a dwelling place in which God lives by his Spirit. Chapter 3, I pray you'll be strengthened with power through his Spirit in your inner being. What's the source of your power? It is the Holy Spirit. In chapter 4, verse 3, he says, make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit. And in chapter 4, verse 30, he warns them, do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God with whom you are sealed for the day of redemption. And against this very full background that he's already talked to them about, of the working of the Holy Spirit in their lives as believers, as Christians, he now gives this command, be filled with the Spirit. And it is a command, it's not just a suggestion. He says in verse 15, be very careful how you live. Then in verse 17, don't be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. So you need to be very careful about this, and don't be foolish about this. Understand this, be filled with the Spirit. Now I want to talk to you about this morning, because if we are Christian, and I will talk about what that means in a moment, because there may well be many of us here this morning who are not Christian, and many listening on television and radio, and you may not have any real understanding of what it means to be a Christian, what that mark is that brings a person into that position where they are Christian as opposed to not yet being Christian. But for those of us who are Christian, to live in the fullness of the Holy Spirit is absolutely essential that we understand and appropriate and live in the richness of that. And there are people here this morning, and the Spirit of God is at work in your heart. He's drawing you. You're not yet into that position whereby you have become indwelt by the Holy Spirit. But that's his task, is to draw us and to convict us and to persuade us. And it is not natural. The natural person does not receive the things that come from the Spirit. It is the Spirit who creates this appetite. And so there are people who are without the Spirit of God, without the Holy Spirit. Secondly, there are people who have the Holy Spirit, yet they grieve the Holy Spirit. What that means is that they are spiritually alive, but they are grieving and quenching. Those two words are used of how we may negatively respond to the Holy Spirit. We are grieving or quenching the Holy Spirit. Just in the previous chapter, chapter 4, verse 30, Paul warns of this. Do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Now, he puts in the past tense, you were sealed, so they become recipients of the Holy Spirit and were sealed by the Holy Spirit. But in the present tense, do not grieve him, because it's possible to have received him, but to be grieving him, which means that we don't allow him to do in us that for which he was given to us. Now, the phrase, 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 19 says, do not quench the Spirit. That's how the King James Version puts it. The NIV, which I'm using, says, do not put out the Spirit's fire. The Amplified Bible says, do not quench or suppress or subdue the Holy Spirit. Because we can do this in such a way that we put out the Spirit's fire. That is, though we have been recipients of the Spirit, if I can put it this way, we close him down as far as his active working within us, and we are quenching him. When Paul wrote to the church in Corinth, his first letter to the Corinthians talks about this when he says to them in chapter 3, verse 1, brothers, he says, I could not address you as spiritual, but as worldly, the NIV says. The King James Bible says, as carnal. The literal Greek word from which this is translated says, as fleshly ones. Now, Paul sets up the contrast between the Spirit, the work of the Spirit in us, and the flesh, not being our body, but my natural self, all that I am apart from God. And he says, I can't address you as spiritual, even though you are indwelt by the Spirit and are Christian. I can only address you as people of the flesh. That is, you are living on your own agenda, even though you have the Holy Spirit. And he goes on to say in verse 3 of 1 Corinthians 3, he says, let me, you're still worldly, carnal, fleshly, for there is jealousy and quarreling among you. Are you not worldly or fleshly? Are you not acting like mere men? That is, you're acting as though the Spirit of God has no role in your life, because when he does, you don't behave this way, you don't act this way, but you've quenched him, you've grieved him, you've shut him down. And you know, the biggest enemy to the work of God are the people of God who are content to live in the flesh instead of living in the Spirit. When Paul speaks in Ephesians 4, grieving the Holy Spirit, he then immediately says in the next verse, which is chapter 4, verse 31, get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, brawling, and slander, along with every form of malice. Because you can be sure of this, when there is bitterness in our hearts, when there's rage and anger and brawling and slander and malice, all those are poisonous things. You can be absolutely sure of this, that the Holy Spirit is being grieved. And if you're a Christian here this morning, and these things are true in your life or mine, we must deal with them. It is a warning that we must not grieve the Holy Spirit. So there are those persons who are without the Holy Spirit. There are those persons who have the Holy Spirit but who are grieving him. And there are persons or people with the Spirit who are filled by the Spirit. Now, this phrase, filled with the Spirit, is one of the better known phrases to be associated with the Holy Spirit in the New Testament. There are many phrases associated with his work. It talks about receiving the Holy Spirit. The Bible talks about baptism with the Holy Spirit, talks about sealing with the Holy Spirit. All of those refer to a one-time event where the Holy Spirit is received. He baptizes us into Christ. We are sealed by the Holy Spirit. Those are not repeatable things. But when it talks about the fullness of the Holy Spirit, although it does also include a beginning, and there are moments when somebody is filled with the Holy Spirit as a single event, an experience, it is also, and more importantly so, it is an ongoing relationship with the Holy Spirit. In fact, this verse should literally be translated in the present continuous tense. Instead of be filled, it's legitimate to translate it be being filled or go on being filled with the Spirit as an ongoing day-by-day relationship with Him. Now, let me just talk about this phrase, to be filled with the Spirit or to be full of the Spirit. It occurs 14 times altogether in the New Testament. And this is the only occasion Paul ever talks about being filled with the Spirit. There's one occasion here in Ephesians 5 and verse 18. The other 13 occasions in the New Testament are all written by Luke. Luke wrote the Gospel of Luke, and then he wrote his second volume, what we call the book of Acts. And in the Gospel of Luke, he talks four times about people being filled with the Spirit, John the Baptist, his mother Elizabeth, his father Zechariah, and then Jesus, after his baptism, as he went into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil for 40 days, it says Jesus, full of the Spirit, was led into the wilderness. So those are the four occasions that Luke uses this phrase. After Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit is poured out and marks the birth of the church, and he is made available to all people, this term occurs nine times. But the phrase is never given a definition in the New Testament. It doesn't say, this is what it means. And so we have to work out its definition by observation of what happens when people are described as being filled or full of the Holy Spirit. And I want to give you four contexts in which this phrase is used. Three of them are in the book of Acts. The first context in which it's used is it's used of an event when something happens and people are filled with the Holy Spirit. You find it in Acts chapter 2, which is the day of Pentecost, the day the church was born. Jesus Christ had lived, died, been raised again from the dead, had spent 40 days after his resurrection with his disciples, had ascended to his Father, and 10 days later, he had promised them he would do this. His Holy Spirit was poured out. There were 120 people meeting together in Jerusalem praying, and it says in verse 2 of Acts chapter 2, suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them, and all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit. That is, they received the Holy Spirit in that initial outpouring, and the result was they were filled with the Holy Spirit. It's important to recognize that these 120 people, though some of them have been disciples of Jesus, were not yet Christian in the full sense that is now possible and that we understand it. Jesus said in John 14 and verse 17 to his disciples about the Holy Spirit, he lives with you and he will be in you. That's the difference Pentecost would make. He is with you, alongside you, he's going to be in you. On the day of Pentecost, he came to live within them, and as a result, they were filled with the Holy Spirit, whatever that means. And we'll come to that, of course, in a few minutes. Then you have the occasion when Saul of Tarsus met Jesus on the Damascus Road. He was the arch enemy of the church, you remember? He was gone to Damascus for the purpose of arresting Christians there. He had this dramatic encounter with Christ, this bright shining light, and he heard the voice speak to him. It was the voice of the Lord Jesus. He said, who are you, Lord? He said, I'm Jesus whom you're persecuting. He became blinded from the light. He was led into Damascus and spent 3 days in a house there. And after 3 days, it says, a man in Damascus who is a Christian called Ananias went to the house and entered it. Placing his hands on Saul, he said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you are coming here, has sent me so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit." And scales fell away from Saul's eyes, and he was filled with the Holy Spirit. You remember, he wasn't converted on the Damascus Road, because although he met with Jesus, he went into conviction, became aware that something was radically wrong. He'd seen something of Christ. And elsewhere it says, when Ananias came to him, he said to him, "Rise, be baptized, wash away your sins." His sins hadn't been washed away yet. And when Ananias came, that's when he was forgiven and cleansed, and the Spirit came to live in him, and the Spirit filled him. So here you have, in these two instances, the receiving of the Holy Spirit leads immediately to being filled with the Holy Spirit. I would suggest that that is what's intended to be the norm. It often isn't, usually for one of two reasons. Either ignorance, we don't understand that that is the intent of God, that his Holy Spirit would fill our lives, or it may be through disobedience that we refuse to surrender everything we are to him, and therefore we keep him out and we grieve him and we lock him up into some corner. But that's the first thing in the book of Acts. The fullness of the Holy Spirit was an event. Secondly, it was a condition. What do I mean by that? Well, in Acts chapter 7, there were some men, or 6 and 7, there were some men who had needed to look after the practical needs of the church. It was getting big. They were getting busy. The apostles needed to appoint other people to look after these practical issues. And in Acts 6, verse 3, it says, "Brothers, choose 7 men from among you who are known to be full of the Spirit and wisdom." Notice that. Not known to have a testimony that says, "On a certain date I was filled," but they're known to be full. If you meet them on Sunday with the believers, they're full of the Spirit. There's something about them that's inexplicable apart from the Holy Spirit. But if you meet them on Monday at work, they're full of the Spirit. You meet them on Tuesday evening at home with their wives and kids, or their husbands and kids, they are full of the Spirit. If you meet them on Thursday, when they're having a cup of coffee with a neighbor, they're full of the Spirit. There's something about them which is constant and continuous that is explicable only by the fact that the Holy Spirit is living within them. It's a condition of life. We're not meant to bounce from experience to experience to experience to experience. We're intended to live in continuous relationship with God that is characterized by the fact that we are full of the Holy Spirit. Stephen, who was one of those men who was appointed, and it says about him that they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Spirit. So he met all those criteria. But Stephen later became the first martyr when he challenged the Sanhedrin Council in Jerusalem, and they got angry with him, had him stoned to death. And it says when he was about to be stoned that Stephen, full of the Holy Spirit, looked up to heaven and saw the glory of God. Full, not filled, full. That's his condition. And they actually said of Stephen, his face looked like the face of an angel, because whatever else it meant that his face showed what was going on inside his heart, that he was full of the Holy Spirit. And in chapter 11, verse 24, there's a man called Barnabas, one of my favorite characters in the book of Acts. It describes him this way: he was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and faith. Not a good man who had been filled, but is full of the Holy Spirit and lives in that condition of fullness. It's a mistake if we think of any part of the Christian life merely as events that happen and that's it. We live day by day within the relationship into which God has called us and brought us. So it was a condition. And thirdly, in the book of Acts, it was an equipping, because there are people who are already filled with the Holy Spirit, who are presumably full of the Holy Spirit, and yet they're brought into certain situations where it calls for particular empowering, and it says of them in those situations, filled with the Holy Spirit, they did something. For instance, in Acts chapter 4 and verse 8, when Peter, one of the apostles, stood before the Sanhedrin Council, it says, "Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them," and you have the message he gave to them. And it was a message which required boldness and courage, and he was filled with the Holy Spirit to enable him to do that. In chapter 4, verse 31, after Peter and John were released from prison in Jerusalem, it says, "After they prayed, the place where they were meeting," this is meeting back with the other Christians, "the place where they were meeting was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God boldly." Now, Peter and John were already filled, but now it's to enable them to speak boldly that they are filled in this equipping way, where when you listen to them speak, you knew the only explanation was the Spirit of God is at work in these people's lives. In chapter 13, verse 9, Saul in Cyprus met a sorcerer called Elymas, who was demon-possessed. And this man followed them around for a while, and Saul of Tarsus ignored them. But then it says in chapter 13, verse 9, then Saul, who is also called Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, looked straight at Elymas and said, "You are a child of the devil and an enemy of everything that is right." And he rebuked him. But he was filled with the Holy Spirit for that task as he engaged with this demonic man. And in chapter 13, verse 52, as Paul and Barnabas and others were expelled from a town called Pisidian Antioch and driven out on their first missionary journey, they met with the other disciples, and it says the disciples were filled with joy and with the Holy Spirit. They were now re-equipped for the next stage in this journey they were being taken on. Now, I've given to you all the references in the book of Acts where this phrase, to be filled with the Holy Spirit or to be full of the Holy Spirit, is used. It's an event on some occasions that happens. They were filled there and then, and we saw the difference. It was a condition on other occasions. This is the way they are: Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, January, June, August, December. It doesn't matter when you meet them. They are full. And it is an equipping where, faced with a particular challenge, they throw themselves on God, and there is this particular filling, we might even call it an anointing, an empowering that is particular for that event and that occasion where this phrase is used. There's only one more occasion when this term is used. It's here in Ephesians chapter 5. And if it was an event or a condition or an equipping in the book of Acts, it is a command here in Ephesians 5. It is a command, as I said, in the present continuous tense, to be being filled, to go on being filled with the Spirit. Now listen, when God states something as a promise, God is responsible to fulfill it. When God issues something as a command, we are responsible to fill it. And there's certain things that, of course, are the work of the Holy Spirit. That is an expression of the sovereignty of God and the working of God. Jesus said about the Holy Spirit to Nicodemus in John's Gospel, chapter 3 and verse 8. He said, "The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you can't tell where it comes from or where it's going. So is everyone born of the Spirit." There's something inexplicable about why the Holy Spirit works in such a way that this person comes to Christ and that person doesn't. Because it is the Holy Spirit's task to work in people's hearts in whatever circumstances will make that appropriate for him, and he works in all kinds of circumstances that we don't anticipate, that suddenly brings us face to face with the work of God. Very often, you know, it's in times of difficulty. Very often it's in times that we don't expect it. Somebody asked me to pray for them earlier this morning at the end of the first service because they're going through a wilderness time, was the word they used. And I said, "Wilderness times can be very lonely, can't they?" "Yes, they can," she said. You know, Jesus spent 40 days in the wilderness on one occasion. He said, "Yes, I know." And he faced the devil. I said, he did. It was a battle. But you know why he was in the wilderness? He was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil, what it says. At the end of that verse, it says, when he came out of the wilderness, he did so in the power of the Spirit. God does things in wilderness experiences that often don't get done when everything's fine. The Spirit of God works sovereignly in the way he opens us up to things, and some things you least expect are avenues by which the Spirit of God may work in our lives. That's his doing. We can't predict it, but some of us are here this morning, and the Holy Spirit is at work in your experience in life, because although you may not yet be a true Christian, you don't sense that you are. You know there's something going on. There is a tugging. There is a drawing. The wind is blowing. And you hear its sound. You don't know where it comes from or where it's going. But you know the Spirit of God is doing something. He's drawing you to himself. And it's the Holy Spirit alone who reveals to us Christ. It's the Holy Spirit alone who convicts of sin and righteousness and judgment. And these things are taught us clearly in Scripture. However, although there are promises the Spirit makes about his working, many times I pray for people that the Spirit of God will be working in them or on them to awaken their hearts. He does that, and the person involved often doesn't know what's going on until they come to life and you have an experience of God. Many of us here, you look back and you see that God brought you into relationship with himself. And before that, he was doing all kinds of things to draw you into relationship with himself. That is his business. Any promise God makes about the Holy Spirit, he is responsible to fulfill. But when he makes a command, the responsibility is on us. And this is not a promise, it is a command. It is an obligation. Be filled with the Spirit. You and I this morning are responsible to understand and respond to what that command means in our lives. So what does it mean? Let me first dispel a couple of areas of confusion that I had in my own life, which some of you may have. To be filled with the Holy Spirit does not mean to have more of the Holy Spirit than we had before, because the Holy Spirit is a personal being. We talked about this about 3 weeks ago. And if he is a personal being, you either have him in your life or you don't have him in your life. But this word filled is a word that we use, you know, we fill our car with gas. You kind of pour more gas into it. Or you fill your cup with coffee. You kind of pour more coffee into your cup. And we kind of think of it as a topping up. And we might be tempted to think in terms of, well, okay, the Holy Spirit's in, but I need topping up with the Holy Spirit. That is not the way to understand this. He is not an impersonal power, as I had said a few weeks ago. You can have more of a person's trust or confidence, or love, or less of that from a person, but you can't have more or less of the person. He's not like a wind against which you fly a kite, or steam by which you might drive an engine, or gasoline by which you might run a car. He is a personal being. He is in you, or he is not. In fact, Paul said to the Corinthians, the very people he talked about their carnality and the fact that they were worldly and living fleshly lives, that's the phrase he uses. He says to those, don't you know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit? He is in you. And you're not your own. So it doesn't mean more of the Holy Spirit. Second thing which led me into confusion for some time, and which we don't hear as much talk about as there used to be when I was growing up, but certainly I heard this, and some of you will have heard this, if you're going to be filled with the Holy Spirit, then you first got to be emptied of yourself. Have you heard that? Well, it sounded logical. And so I tried to empty myself of myself. I ran into two problems. Number one, what is myself? And secondly, how do you empty it anyway? And then I found verses like Galatians 5, verse 17, which says to us that the flesh, that is the old nature, desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the old nature. They are in conflict with each other. And I discovered that actually, right through my life, and it continues so and will continue until the day I leave this earth and go to heaven, there will be a civil war in my soul of an old nature that fights against the Spirit. You cannot get rid of that. You cannot empty it out of your life. It is true. We need to confess and deal with things that are wrong, that grieve the Spirit. But that is not to empty those things out. I think the clue to understanding what it means to be filled with the Holy Spirit is to realize that Luke uses this word filled of other things in other contexts. And I think that his use of the word filled in other contexts will help us understand the meaning of being filled with the Holy Spirit. So for an example, in Acts chapter 3 and verse 10, there was a man who was crippled and begging at the temple gate in Jerusalem. Peter and John came along and they didn't have anything to give him. And Peter said, "Silver and gold I don't have, but what I do have, I'll give you. In the name of Jesus, get up." And the man jumped to his feet and was healed. And he began to walk and run and skip around the place. And a crowd gathered because they all knew this man. And it says of the crowd in Acts 3 verse 10, they were filled with wonder and amazement. What did he mean? They were filled with wonder and amazement. In Acts chapter 5, great things were happening in Jerusalem. Lots of people were coming to know Christ. And it speaks about the Sadducees. And it says the Sadducees were filled with jealousy. What does it mean to be filled with jealousy? In Acts 13, verse 45, Paul and Barnabas were in Pisidian Antioch on their first journey. And the Jews, it says there, were filled with envy when they saw what was happening. In chapter 13, verse 52, Paul and Barnabas were persecuted and driven out of the city of Pisidian Antioch. They met with the disciples, and it says, and the disciples were filled with joy and with the Holy Spirit. What does it mean to be filled with joy? Acts 16, 34, the Philippian jailer, who you remember, was converted at midnight. He was filled with joy because he'd come to believe in God. Now, there are other references too. That'll be sufficient. What does it mean to be filled with wonder and filled with amazement and filled with jealousy and filled with envy and filled with joy? Because if we understand that, we may understand what it means to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Same word. Well, I suggest you this, that to be filled with wonder, amazement, jealousy, envy, and joy means that these emotions, those are primarily emotions, dominated their personalities and determined their behavior. What does it mean to be filled with the Holy Spirit? That the Holy Spirit dominates our personality and determines our behavior. That whatever's going on inside is very evident on the outside. I think it's very interesting that Paul contrasts this with being drunk, as in the same verse, he says, do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit. Now, why is he suddenly talking about being drunk? It's not even relevant to the passage. Or maybe because being drunk, in some ways, not in every way at all, but in some ways, is an illustration of what it means to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Because it's also interesting, on the day of Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit came and the 120 were filled with the Holy Spirit, the first explanation people gave was, these men are drunk. You remember that? So when Peter got up to explain to the crowd and to preach the gospel to them, he began by having to deal with that issue and said, these men are not drunk as you suppose. It is only 9 o'clock in the morning. In other words, the pubs aren't open yet. Three ways you could tell a man was drunk: the way he walked, the way he talked, the way he smelled. How do you know when a person is filled with the Holy Spirit? Let me suggest three giveaway evidences: the way he walks, the way he talks, the way he smells. Now, before you start claiming great spirituality for the person next to you, let me explain what I mean by that. The way we walk, Paul says, walk in love. He says in Galatians 5, verse 16, walk in the Spirit. The New International Version says live in the Spirit or live by the Spirit. Actually, the word there is the Greek word in the original text is the word walk. Why they changed it, I don't know. Walk in the Spirit. 1 John 1 says walk in the light as he is in the light. In other words, as you move through life, the way you walk is such. You walk in the Spirit, you walk in love, you walk in the light, that is, you're open and transparent and honest. Remember a man, very godly man, who died when I was young. I didn't go to his funeral, but somebody told me what had been said at his funeral. And somebody had said this about this particular man: you never caught him off guard because he never needed to be on guard. He was genuine all the way through. He walked in the light. He was a spirit-filled man. And you know, the first people see of us is the way we walk. Is there something about us that gives evidence of the spirit of Jesus Christ? That gives evidence of love and kindness? That gives evidence of honesty, transparency? Because the man, the woman filled with the Holy Spirit will show by the way they walk. Secondly, by the way they talk. It's very interesting. Every time it speaks of people being filled with the Holy Spirit, as opposed to defining them as full, when they are filled with the Spirit, something happens to their mouth. On the day of Pentecost, they all spoke in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Other occasions, Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said, and you have him speaking. Something happens to the mouth. Here in Ephesians 5, it says in the next verse, after saying, instead, be filled with the Spirit, speak to one another. Why? Because as Jesus said in Matthew 12, verse 34, out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. If you want to know what's going on in a person's heart, hang around long enough. You know the kind of things that come out of their mouth, or the kind of things they write about, or the kind of things they talk about, or the kind of they say to people quietly. You know, the mouth is a thermometer of the heart. It tells you what's going on inside. Of course, we can behave ourselves and say the right things and the nice things and the proper things in the right context, but I'm talking about that. Hang around long enough. And the kind of things that come out of the mouth will give evidence of the true condition of the heart. And one of the first things that happens when the Spirit of God fills the heart is the kind of things we talk about is impacted. The way we walk, the way we talk, the way we smell. Now, some of you will think I must be exaggerating this, but I'm not. In 2 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 14, let me read you what Paul says there. Verse 14, 15, 16, he says, thanks be to God who always leads us in triumphal procession in Christ and through us, listen to this, through us spreads everywhere the fragrance of the knowledge of Christ. For we are to God the aroma of Christ among those who are being saved and those who are perishing. Putting it crudely, we smell of Jesus. He says that is to the Father. Then he says about those around us, to the one, we are the smell of death. That is to those who are perishing, he says there. And to the other, that is to those who are saved, we are the fragrance of life. Now says Paul, the work of God in us is such that we spread everywhere the fragrance of Christ. There is an aroma of Christ. And some people will hate you for it because it exposes them. It's the smell of death to them. But those who are believers, it says, it'd be the smell of life. But we are the aroma of Christ, says Paul. You know, people need to know you're a Christian. Because there's something about your life that is different. You can't orchestrate it, but you can live in such a relationship with Jesus Christ, in such dependence on him, in such love for him. And by the way, and we won't talk about this, I'll just mention it, that when Paul says, be filled with the Spirit, it's in the context of speak to one another with psalms, hymns, spiritual songs, thank music in your heart, etc. In the book of Colossians, which has a lot of very similar things to Ephesians, he makes the same statement, though instead of saying be filled with the Spirit, he says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. as you sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs will gladden your hearts to God. So he takes the same context. One, he says, be filled with the Spirit. The other says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. And of course, Christ ministers himself to us through his word. And if we're people who spend time in this word and allow God to speak to us in his word, as we live in dependence upon the Spirit of God, as we live in that open spirit of repentance and trust, some people hate what they see. They will hate it. It's the aroma of death to them. But some people will want to know what makes you tick. And they will see the evidence of the Spirit of God in the way you walk, in the way you talk, and in the very atmosphere of your life. Now, how is that fullness expressed? Let me finish with this. He says in verse 19, speak to one another. Later in verse 19, sing and make music in your hearts to God. In verse 21, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Three very practical things. Speak to one another. That is, when the Spirit of God fills your life, he changes your relationships. You speak to one another. You sing and make music to the Lord. He puts a new song in your mouth, and there's a song of praise because you've got something to sing about. David wrote that in the Psalms. He put a new song into my mouth. I mean, why do Christians sing? Why do we spend the first half hour when we meet together like this singing? Nobody else does that. Because we've got something to sing about. And there are things that can be best expressed in song. That's why I'm going to say something you may not agree with now, but I think it's true that if we do not participate in singing, worship to God, we're probably quenching the Spirit of God in our lives because he gives rise to song. I didn't do it the second service. I looked around the first service while we were singing, and there were some faces that were wonderful to see. They were singing, and their faces said they knew the God they were singing about. Other people looked incredibly miserable. Now, I know you may have had a hard week or whatever, or I know these things are true, but you know, for some of us, we were displaying our hearts on our faces, and it wasn't pretty. But when the Spirit of God gets to work, you sing. Psalms, hymns, spiritual songs. You make music in your heart to the Lord. Why do you sing it out in the psalms, hymns, spiritual songs? Because the music's in your heart. And thirdly, the third one, all begin with S. He says, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. You live in relationships. You don't just speak and sing to God, but you are living in this submission to one another. Many gives in the following verses some practical working of this, the mutual submission of wives to husbands and husbands to wives. Submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Of parents to children and children to parents. Submit to one another. And masters to workers or servants to masters and masters to servants. Submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. We're going to pick up those practical aspects over the next few weeks. But the point is this, that the fullness of the Holy Spirit doesn't put your head into the clouds and makes you useless for anything else. The fullness of the Holy Spirit puts your feet back on the ground and makes you incredibly useful in relationships where you bring life and energy. Now, how do we know the fullness of the Holy Spirit? Do you know there's no formula laid down in the New Testament? Because it is a continuous day-by-day relationship of dependence and obedience. But it does say, as you receive Christ, so live in him. We receive him, and the way we live in him are the same. We receive him on the basis of repentance towards God, turning from sin, and faith in Christ, trust in Christ. That's how we live. We go on living every day with that attitude. And there's a verse in Luke 11 when Jesus said, if you then, though you're evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? Now he says, ask him. And there is that asking. There are times when the laying on of hands was part of it. To show the fellowship. This is a corporate thing in the body of Christ. But our day-by-day filling is coming every day, acknowledging my need of repentance, confessing my sin, my trust in Christ. He is sufficient for me no matter what I face today. And simply asking, Spirit of God, fill me with yourself. And trust him for that. And you're not the one who's going to see it. It's the way you walk, the way you talk, the way you smell. It's other people around you who will see it and know it. Maybe that you've never yet received him. That's the first category of people I referred to. The man without the Spirit does not understand the things of the Spirit. But God is drawing you. And this morning, you can give your life to Jesus Christ, and as you give your life to him, he will give his life to you, his Spirit to you, and you will come into union with himself, and you'll be born again of the Holy Spirit. You'll receive him and begin that life which can be lived in his fullness. Some of you are Christians, and you're grieving him, and you know that. And in your marriage together, in your family life, in your work life, you are grieving the Spirit of God. You need to confess that and repent of that. And ask him to fill you. That every part of your life is lived under his enabling and empowering. And if you are a person here this morning and you are filled with the Spirit, you go on living in the fullness day by day, acknowledging, Father, I need the Spirit of God today. I need the Spirit of God today. I need the Spirit of God to fill me and work in me and work through me.
Thank you for watching. We love to hear from you. Send your comments through our website, livingtruth.ca, or write to us at the address on your screen. You can also contact us by phone at 1-888-269-6085. Living Truth is supported by our viewers. Thanks to your financial participation, lives are being transformed through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Living Truth is a registered Canadian charity, and donations receive a tax receipt.
Tune in again next week when Charles Price continues his series on Ephesians, Responsibilities in Marriage.
Christianity is not just a certain set of facts we believe to be true. It's an experience of spiritual life. Growing Up in Christ is a 10-part series by Charles Price. It will inspire us to grow spiritually as we enjoy the fullness of the Holy Spirit. This 10-part series, based on the book of Ephesians, is available on CD and DVD. To order this series, write to the address on your screen. To order online, visit livingtruth.ca. Unlock your spiritual capacity with this inspiring series, Growing Up in Christ. It's an experience of spiritual life.
I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather have him than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses on land. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hand than to be the king of the vast domain. or be held in sin's dread sway. Ooh, I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords to give. I'd rather have Jesus than man's applause. I'd rather be faithful to his due cause. Oh, I'd rather have Jesus than wealth or fame, and I'd rather be true to his holy name than to be the king of the vast domain or be held in sin's dread sway. Ooh, I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords to give. You see, I don't want anything, and all I want is here.